Good afternoon and welcome, everybody. On behalf of President Biden and Secretary Blinken, I'd like to welcome everybody here today to our World Cup Watch Party and our celebration of sport diplomacy. We have a really fantastic group here today, members of our diplomatic corps, athletes, leaders in sports organizations, and of course, all of us, hopefully, World Cup enthusiasts. I am Scott Weinbold. I'm the Acting Assistant Secretary for the Bureau of Education and Cultural Affairs here at the Department of State. And that acting title is there for a very good reason, which is our Assistant Secretary is in Qatar right now with Secretary Blinken. A few hours ago, they had a really great, exciting soccer event with young people there, people from Qatar and other places, as part of our sport diplomacy programs. And Secretary Blinken and the delegation are going to be in the stadium, very envious of them, watching the same match that we're going to watch in a few minutes. It's a really great pleasure to see so many soccer fans here in a room named for Benjamin Franklin, lifelong diplomat and statesman. You might not know he was also a lifelong athlete, a swimmer his entire life. At the State Department, our ties between sports and diplomacy run deep. President Biden has said, all of our nations are linked by deeply rooted shared values that unlock incredible opportunities. But the principal driver of our relationships is a connection between our peoples. People-to-people exchanges, like sports, are life-changing, not just in our own lives, but also in the lives of so many others. My father was a U.S. diplomat, and I grew up playing soccer in Asia and Africa. And I found out as a child how sport, and especially soccer as the dominant worldwide sport, opens doors and sparks friendship. It's not always easy being a new kid in a school or a neighborhood, but if you can play soccer, it doesn't matter if you still struggle in the local language, if you perhaps look different from the other people around you, or you don't even know anybody outside your family. You'll always find a pickup match in the local empty lot, or maybe even in the middle of the street where you all yell car when you see a car coming. Pretty soon you'll have a whole new group of friends, and that's an amazing connection. We all understand how critical sports programs are in building inclusive communities in the United States and abroad, and how sports can be literal game changers for youth in building skills like teamwork, fortitude, leadership that will serve them their entire lives. In the State Department, one strategic aspect of our sports diplomacy work are the Sports Visitor Program participants. We bring participants from around the world to the United States, athletes and coaches, to explore U.S. society, culture, and history through the lens of sports. These athletes and coaches engage with their American peers, both on and off the field of play, broadening their views of diversity, inclusion, and American values. Another key component of our sports diplomacy efforts are sports envoys. High-level American athletes and coaches and figures who travel overseas to engage with youth on the field, the pitch, the court, or beyond. These athletes also address key issues of the day, such as democracy, civic engagement, diversity, and inclusion. Since 2006, the State Department has teamed up with U.S. Soccer to engage more than 60 current or former players from both the U.S. women's and men's national teams to serve as sports envoys. In fact, we have one of our most esteemed sports envoys here with us today. I'm extremely proud to introduce our guest of honor, who is an accomplished athlete, sports executive, and a U.S. Department of State sports envoy. Mary Harvey is the chief executive at the Center for Sports and Human Rights. Prior to joining the center, Mary led the development of the human rights strategy for the successful united bid to bring the 2026 FIFA World Cup to North America. Mary enjoyed an 8-year career with the U.S. Women's National Soccer Team, winning the inaugural FIFA Women's World Cup in 1991 and Olympic gold in 1996.
She has been a champion for women and girls, marginalized groups, and environmental stewardship. Mary is a leader and a mentor who has spent her career building inclusive communities globally through sports. She has served as a Department of State sports envoy in Iraq, in Jordan, Canada, Mexico, and other places. Mary, we applaud your efforts. Welcome to the stage.
Well, thank you. Wow, that's kind of exhausting hearing about that. And first of all, I'd like to just, once a teammate, always a teammate. Where's Kim Maslin, Camera Diner? 91 teammate, world champion, just recognizing Kim in there. You never leave a teammate out. So, Deputy Secretary Sherman, excellencies and colleagues, welcome to you all. And the greatest sporting event on earth is finally here. And I call it that because, as you've already heard, I'm not objective. Not even a little bit objective. That's because, as you've already heard, stole my thunder, I am a former member of the U.S. Women's National Soccer Team. And Kim and I both know what it's like to play in a World Cup. And let me tell you, it is unlike anything I think we've ever experienced. There's something electric about the World Cup. It's like you plugged the audience or the fans and the stadium into an electric socket. It just vibrates like that. It's just incredible. And playing in a World Cup gives you a chance to find out what you're made of. And I have to say, it has been an absolute gift to find that out about myself at such a young age. But when I reflect back on that time of my life, I didn't know the impact sport would have on the trajectory of my life. It would take me to nearly 50 countries. It would require me to learn 3 languages outside of my native English. I would work for most of my professional career as an expatriate outside my native country. I would lead and be the chief executive for at least 3 organizations, become a human rights advocate, and play a key role in the World Cup itself, embedding respect for human rights. So I'd like to share with you 3 things that I learned during that journey from when I was a player, and these 3 things I use every single day. So the first is, and this has already been said, coming from the sport, this sport, means you have a language in common with the rest of the world. It is a language in and of itself, the sport of soccer. I'm in Iraq and I'm talking to kids and asking them, do they support Barcelona or Real Madrid? And inevitably there's an argument. But it is, the sport itself of soccer is a language in and of itself, and I feel so fortunate that the sport that I played was not only a team sport, but this sport. Second, I learned tremendous compassion and empathy because I knew what it was like. I knew what it felt like to be the stranger in the strange land. I knew what it felt like not to be able to communicate in my mother tongue and have to communicate with others when it wasn't so easy. And I learned what it felt like to live in my American skin in different parts of the world. And finally, I gained an understanding of how my actions, basically what I say and what I do, how that affects and impacts those around me. Because if you didn't get that, believe me, your teammates will drill it into you. So it was those qualities that led me to the doors and allowed me to be selected to be one of the U.S. State Department sports envoys. And it's part of the U.S. State Department sport envoy program. So through, as a sports envoy, I had an opportunity to connect with girls and women and their parents and coaches in the countries that were mentioned, Iraq, Jordan, and the Americas. And we would talk about why sport matters. And that sometimes you have to ask and ask and ask and ask again, not accepting no, because you want to create the future that you want for yourself. You're an active participant in your future. So I'd like to close with a few thoughts about why 2022 was a year unlike no other. This year is special, and this World Cup is special because it brought human rights into the mainstream. The world is talking about the importance of human rights. Just open up the New York Times, Washington Post, whatever media you consume, they're talking about human rights. Why? because of sports. And because of a sporting event, or sporting events, I should say. So in a world where in recent years, human rights and multilateralism has been under attack, players, governments, sponsors, broadcasters, workers, fans, journalists, and nearly everyone is talking about human rights. This is why I believe we have an enormous opportunity here in North America. When FIFA opened the bidding process for the 2026 FIFA World Cup, it contained, for the very first time, detailed human rights requirements. It required that all bidders embed commitment to abiding by international human rights standards and the UN guiding principles on business and human rights, and to identifying gaps between those rights and national law and practice, and then developing a strategy to address that gap. And this was done for the public to consume. The human rights strategy was published in the public domain. I had the great privilege of writing that strategy, which was the first ever human rights strategy for a mega sporting event. And with it, the 2026 FIFA World Cup presents an incredible opportunity to bring human rights into the mainstream in North America. That's a pretty big thing to say, right? Well, this is because I spent a lot of time in Geneva, and I come back to the United States, and I start talking about human rights, and the world of sport says, can you unpack that for me? And that's because human rights isn't known as human rights here. It's known by a dozen different names, from civil rights to racial justice to diversity, inclusion, and equality, but not as human rights. So it's an opportunity to connect us with a broader world, to international human rights standards. It will require engagement with civil society and those who will criticize you, organized labor and human rights advocates. And it will be entirely new for the host cities and those in sport who will help put on this event. So the organization I had the great honor to lead, the Center for Sport and Human Rights, founded by our patron, the great Mary Robinson, is designed specifically and specially for this purpose. We help the world of sport understand how its activities impact human rights, and how sport and its events can not only respect human rights, but advance them. We are founded by the UN Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights and the ILO, the two UN agencies where international human rights and labor standards are enshrined, and we work with governments, sponsors, unions, sports bodies, and civil society to help sport become responsible sport. My pleasure to be here today. It's a great honor for me, and I hope you enjoy the match.
Mary, thank you so much for your remarks and for your leadership, and we're really thrilled to have you here with us today. Now it is my great honor to introduce a true champion of our public diplomacy efforts and our sports diplomacy outreach, our Deputy Secretary of State, Wendy Sherman. I'm going to keep this very short, in part because going over achievements could take me an hour, but also because I know she would rather talk sports and soccer and watch sports and soccer rather than for everybody to hear me talk longer. So I will just say that Deputy Secretary Sherman has served with three U.S. presidents and four U.S. secretaries of state, was sworn in as the first female Deputy Secretary of State just over a year ago, and is one of the strongest advocates in the State Department for our public diplomacy programs and our sports diplomacy. And she is here today to share a little bit about her vision for using public diplomacy in addressing global challenges in advancing U.S. foreign policy. Thank you so much, Deputy Secretary.
Okay, so my eyes are on the clock, so I'm going to talk fast. Because, you know, you're not here for me, or even for Mary, or for Scott. You're here to watch the game. You may have noticed. So, thank you, Scott. And thanks to everyone in our Bureau of Education and Cultural Affairs and our Office of Protocol for organizing this event. We are really fortunate to have so many distinguished guests with us today. There's our diplomatic corps. There's a superstar on the field and in sports diplomacy, Mary Harvey. There's staff from across the State Department representing nearly every corner of this agency. Yay, staff! And among them is one incredible member of our team, Walter. Walter, where are you? Ah, okay. Walter, come forward, Walter, so everybody can see you. Walter Devenish, who can boast what nobody else here can. He actually played in a World Cup qualifying match when he suited up for his native Guyana over 40 years ago. He works here at the Department of State. Walter, it is a real privilege to have you here. So we never know who works with us. No matter where we're from, as everyone said, soccer has played a role in all our lives. For me, it goes back to taking my daughter to practice from age 7 when she and her best friend were the only two girls on an all-boys team. She learned to play very aggressive soccer. Through high school, bringing orange slices and snacks for her team to enjoy after games, and feeling such joy watching her coach my two grandsons today. I also remember soccer showing up in a very different context, amidst negotiations over the Iran deal. No joke. It was July 2014, and we were holed up in the Coburg Hotel in Vienna. As some might recall, there were a few disagreements to iron out in those talks. But on one item, everyone was on the same page. We had to schedule our meetings around the semifinal between Germany and Brazil. Trust me, no one dissented on this provision. By the time the ref placed the ball at center field, or as the British call it, Madam Ambassador, the pitch, we were all glued to our televisions. It was a light moment in a serious time. Yet it was a reminder of what sports can do that my colleagues have spoken of today, how sports can be a unifying force and a universal language, how sports can transcend borders, challenge gender stereotypes, and teach the value of fair play. Perhaps most important, sports instills something in young people: confidence and cooperation, communication and teamwork, persistence and determination. And girls learn to throw a sharp elbow if necessary. It can show us how to persevere, how to come back when you fall behind, how to win, how to lose, with grace and treat an opponent with dignity. It can lift up the message of our common humanity, that we are all one human family, no matter your race, ethnicity, or religion, no matter your sexual orientation or gender identity. Just as in the beautiful game on the field and on our planet, everyone has a chance to make their mark, everyone is valued, and everyone belongs. These are life lessons that apply in a soccer match just as much as they do in a workplace, in government, in business, anywhere. These are certainly lessons we can and should apply in the realm of foreign affairs. That's why we are so invested in sports diplomacy programs here at the State Department, efforts that help us reach underrepresented populations worldwide and advance the principles of diversity, equity, inclusion, and accessibility. More than half of these initiatives are driven by the commitments enshrined in the Americans with Disabilities Act and Title IX, perhaps one of the greatest things ever passed here in the United States. At least a quarter of our exchanges are designed to strengthen our work around human rights, LGBTQI+ inclusion, and racial justice. These programs find us empowering women and girls and building ties between athletes and coaches worldwide. These efforts see us deploying athletic legends as goodwill envoys across the globe. Stars like Mary Harvey and Olympic champions like Michelle Kwan, who once served as a public diplomacy representative at the State Department and now serves as our ambassador to Belize. Sports diplomacy, in short, helps us connect with people of all ages, all nationalities, and all backgrounds in a unique way. We see each other in a new light, and they see our country as a teammate. We find areas of common ground. That's the power of sports. Indeed, I'm going to ask my grandsons over Thanksgiving to turn in their Pokemon cards for Panini stickers. That's the best of diplomacy. So now, before we tune into a match, there's one more important bit of business to handle, the all-important wager between myself and my colleagues from the United Kingdom. Earlier today, I met with Britain's deputy head of mission, James Roscoe, who is from Wales. And we made it official. If Wales manages to win, I'll present him with a bottle of American bourbon. But when our players prevail, James will owe me a selection of Welsh whiskey to mark the occasion. I'll simply warn you, though, President Biden likes to say, and I know you've heard it, it's never been a good bet to bet against America. I sure hope he's right. Go Team USA, and thank you for being here. Let's all enjoy the match. Thank you. I think we've got a couple minutes to the match. Go enjoy. Thank you.